Like a genie released from a bottle, it has the capacity for great good or terrible evil.
The word profound, I think, can definitely be applied to it, because any time you have the occasion, whatever it may be, to have a real shift in consciousness, it is definitely profound.
No, it's not addicting. No, it does not affect your genetic system. Do people go crazy under it? Absolutely.
It is a drug so powerful that for a brief time during the 1960s, it shook the foundation of society. It spawned the Summer of Love, fueled revolt in the streets, and its main disciple, Timothy Leary, was labeled the most dangerous man in America. Nearly everyone who came into contact with it was deeply affected.
LSD will, without a doubt, without a shadow of a doubt, whatever else you will say about it, will change completely a person's worldview forever. It will never be the same again, whether the experience was positive or negative.
The story of LSD began in Basel, in Switzerland, in 1943. A chemist, Albert Hofmann, stumbled upon a formula for LSD at Sandoz Labs, as he was looking for a drug to stimulate the circulation. For 8 years, Hofmann had been studying the properties of ergot, a fungus that grows on rye kernels. The fungus had a wide and varied reputation. In China and the Middle East, it was known for its medicinal qualities. In ancient Greece, it may have been an ingredient in the sacred drink used in ceremonies at Eleusis. Ergot is also the suspected cause of St. Anthony's fire, a terrifying condition that afflicted people throughout Europe who consumed diseased rye.
And the whole village would go crazy. They would, in essence, go off on an LSD trip. People would end up dancing wildly in the streets, jumping out of windows in their houses.
Hofmann first synthesized ergot as LSD in 1938, but he had no idea of its potential. On April the 16th, 1943, feeling perhaps that he missed something during his initial tests, he mixed a new batch.
And he apparently absorbed some of the drug through his skin that day, because he began feeling lightheaded and sick, he thought. And so he went home, climbed into bed, and instead of getting flu-like symptoms, he had some rather extraordinary hallucinations.
Intrigued by the experience, Hofmann decided to ingest the drug again the following Monday. He took what he thought was a small dose.
This very small dose, the first dose of my experiments I planned, was very, very strong.
He bicycled home, climbed into bed. His family was away at the time, and so he had a lot of fear that he had perhaps damaged his mind by doing this. He lay in bed. At one point, his consciousness was up on the ceiling, looking down on what he took to be his dead body.
And the object, like his chair, was like if he was a living object. It became moving from inside.
He survived the night, and in the morning, rather than feeling hellish at all, he felt wonderful. He felt reborn. He went out into his garden. Everything was sparkling with life.
Although the drug didn't work as a circulatory stimulant, Hofmann and his colleagues at Sandoz came to the conclusion that LSD may serve as an important tool for studying how the mind works. Little did they realize that they were unleashing upon the world a substance that would have such a profound effect. A substance Hofmann came to call his problem child. But to begin with, Hofmann offered LSD to other researchers who had been working with test subjects to produce altered states of mind by using other drugs like mescaline. These drugs allowed researchers to artificially induce temporary madness and attempt to study mental diseases like schizophrenia.
This was a very important subject in science at the time. It was really felt that the person that could come up with the clue to madness would win a Nobel Prize.
One of these researchers, a pioneer in the study of schizophrenia, was Dr. Humphrey Osmond of Saskatchewan, Canada. During the late 40s and early 50s, his experiments with mescaline gained wide attention. Aldous Huxley, author of Brave New World, closely followed Osmond's work. Even though he was nearly blind, Huxley dedicated his extraordinary intelligence to a continuous quest for knowledge.
And he was considered by European intellectuals probably the brightest young literary man of his generation in any of the Western countries.
Huxley was fascinated by the possibility of expanding his consciousness through drugs like mescaline. He had studied cultures who ingest different plants with hallucinogenic properties to stimulate godlike visions. He thought there might be a mechanism in the brain that could open a door to a higher realm of consciousness. Humphrey Osmond was stunned when Huxley volunteered to be a guinea pig in his mescaline experiments. By using mescaline as a spiritual seeker, not as a scientist, Huxley entered a surreal world of spiritual imagery.
Everything he looked at was transfigured. When he looked at plants, he could just see them, rather like Albert Hofmann before him, you know, bursting with life, bursting with color.
After his experience with mescaline, Huxley began to encourage others to try it too.
In essence, what Huxley was saying was that drugs like LSD should be seen as a potential boon for mankind, for humankind, that they can be used not simply for in a scientific context, but they could be used by normal people to study themselves, to investigate themselves as a tool of self-exploration and self-discovery.
Huxley wrote a book about his experience in 1954 called The Doors of Perception, from the observation by poet William Blake that if the doors of perception were cleansed, everything will appear to man as it is, infinite. The book attracted a wide range of readers, including people in the CIA, the Army, and the Soviet intelligence. Hallucinogenic drugs, and LSD in particular, would soon be targeted as potential weapons. Some physicians saw LSD as a tool for understanding the mind. Philosophers saw it as a key to the spiritual world, but the CIA had other ideas. In 1947, the Cold War had begun, and the newly created Central Intelligence Agency was looking for the perfect truth serum, or mind-controlling drug. Research on LSD was done under the auspices of the top-secret MK-Ultra program, which was designed to develop drugs as weapons of war. LSD received more attention and study than any other drug. It was colorless, odorless, tasteless, and just a small quantity was very powerful. Initial tests, however, of the drug as a truth serum proved disappointing.
And LSD, though being very promising, also was uncontrollable. Some people would get paranoid, but then get blissful. You couldn't really interrogate them because the things that were happening in their mind were sending them elsewhere.
Not willing to give up on LSD, they decided it might be used for covert operations.
You could use it to confuse and embarrass political leaders like Castro or various dictators they wanted to get rid of by somehow slipping at them. So they'd slip it into a cocktail glass and maybe the person would embarrass themselves and do all kinds of crazy things.
For LSD to work in covert operations, surprise was crucial. To test its effects, government researchers covertly slipped it to each other.
And it was normally mixed with Coke or with coffee or milk or something like that. And it's tasteless and colorless, so the man wasn't aware of the fact that he was taking it.
But in fact, that did happen to quite a great degree in the early and mid-1950s. But they had to figure out how to use it properly as an espionage weapon. They would slip into each other's coffee, and then right away they say, oh, by the way, you've gotten it. You know, better prepare to take that day off work.
In November of 1953, during a working retreat at a hunting lodge in Maryland, attended by CIA technicians and Army biological warfare scientists, this unorthodox research got